mentioned, you know, hospitals have found out that if they provide a view of a room that has a view of nature, then they can get some sort of an improved medical outcome. The first time I mentioned that to somebody, they said, "Proof." And 1985, there was some proof done, and I'll talk about this a little bit later, but we want to unpack that idea that access to nature can actually have an improved medical outcome of a patient or a resident. And, you know, so the theory behind supportive design is what this is all about. We're not researchers, we're landscape architects, and we're the applicators of the research, but we've studied some of the research, and that's why I want to share with you, because I got challenged by a CEO of a hospital system who asked me to prove it, very aggressively putting his fist down on the table and said, "Prove it, prove that access to nature has improved medical outcomes and economic outcomes." So my background is I come from a family of physicians. My grandfather was a physician. My dad is 88 years old and is still a licensed practicing physician, although he's slowly, at the ripe old age of 88, decided that maybe he's got something better to do. I have a niece or a nephew who is a radiologist, a niece who is a physical therapist, a sister who's a psychiatrist. And so medicine and being exposed to senior living environments was something I was actually comfortable with. So when I went to school and I got into landscape architecture and I came to Chicago and started practicing about 27 years ago with Hitchcock Design Group, my focus was really towards healthcare and senior living environments. I actually serve on the board of directors for Friendship Senior Options, which is one of the largest continuing care retirement communities in Illinois, with a campus in Schaumburg and Geneva. So it's kind of a passion of mine. It's kind of nice to take landscape architecture and kind of apply it to a field that's kind of somewhat unrelated. So as a landscape architect, I always like to tell people that we do a little bit more than parsley around the meat. A lot of people, you know, you hear the questions a lot of times, you know, how do I get rid of red spider or the chevelera? I'm not really sure. But I do have a design for chevelera. So what is a healing garden? And I wish I had this little elevator speech every time somebody asks me, what makes a garden healing? And then we try to unpack that a little bit more in this presentation. I reference Roger Ulrich, who is a professor, or used to be a professor at Texas A&M, who was kind of the godfather of coining the term evidence-based design, which is where they do research and they find out that if you can change the built environment, you can have an improved medical outcome. And so, you know, this whole idea of fostering or creating this stress reducer that has this implication of improved medical outcomes. And what they've done is they've researched this and they've looked at control groups and they've looked at groups that are exposed to these different environments and have found indicators that are supportive of the idea that you can improve medical outcomes with just your built physical environment, like concept. So this theory of supportive design is, once again, reducing stress helps elevate the immune systems, makes you respond better to treatments, therefore leading to an improved medical outcome. And periodically, I'm showing examples of some of the healing environments that we've designed. This is a healing garden that's down at the Riverside Medical Center in Kankakee. And who benefits from these gardens? Obviously, our initial intent is to have the patient benefit from them. I can point to maybe about 25% of the gardens we design, the patients actually have access to. It's very difficult to find a setting where you can get a patient physically out into the garden space. Now in a senior living environment, 100% of them have access to it. In a hospital setting, it's very challenging. What's interesting is LEED for Healthcare now gives you additional credit if you have a garden that is accessible by a patient, and they've got very strict criteria on what a garden is, what an outdoor environment is. It's not a patio with just a bench on it. It's got to have garden on it. But obviously, you know, the patients, the visitors, the staff, and the administration all get benefit from this. This is a great diagram of the types of elements that we like to see in a healing garden. And I also got an example of the types of elements that we want to avoid in a healing garden. But, you know, we like in our senior living environments in particular with this warm pavement. And folks in senior living environments, a lot of them have macular degeneration, which is, you know, causes a lot of glare. And so when they go out into a patio setting outside on a bright sunny day, and you have that white concrete pavement, it could be very painful. And they like to have their sunglasses. One of the elements that we introduce is that tinted pavement, a very inexpensive way to get the glare down. We like the personalization. As a landscape architect, we don't really like the tchotchkes in a garden, but this is their home, and that's what makes it personal for them. So we like the idea that they take this foundation of a garden setting and they personalize it. We like these natural distractions, we like to call them, like these water features that has the old oak barrel, especially for folks with dementia or memory impairment, where you might introduce an element into the landscape that may be triggered memory from the past. Obviously, providing access to lush vegetation at various levels is an important component. This particular planter, the residents come along the edge and they plant herbs and other flowers, and so it's designed to have thinner edges so they have closer access. It also has a variety of different heights, and there's not an interior right angle, because if you have a wheelchair, you can't get it to the inside of the right angle, but the 45-degree angle is working really well. It's obviously a controlled space. It has a walkway that is looping so that you have a destination at the end of it. We also like choices. So there's bench seating that is by the door. There's bench seating out in the garden. There's table seating that has movable chairs for flexibility. So when they have a special event, they want to have a barbecue, they got the ability to move the furniture. So providing that flexibility is another component we like to see in these garden spaces. So if you reduce, what are the other benefits? There's studies that talk about how patients who have access to nature actually get discharged quicker. And so that can be a reduced cost. So there's all these really great benefits. And staff turnover is really a good one as well. If you create a positive work environment, people are likely to stay longer. I thought it was interesting, here's a hospital system that is now merged with Edward that is using nature as part of an advertising campaign. This is the Wings of Hope Angel Garden that was built over the hospital. It's a terrific space, primarily used by staff as a stress reducer. So some of the research, and this is Roger Ulrich, he's now over in Switzerland, godfather of, I call the godfather of evidence-based design. He's the most cited researcher internationally in evidence-based design. He's done some studies that I know Drew knows about, that it was the first study done back in 1984 that started giving credibility that the built environment can improve a patient outcome in terms of how they respond. And there's also Claire Cooper Marcus, who focuses her efforts primarily on healing environments within senior living. And so if you Google me or either one of those, you'll get a lot of the data that I reference in here. So if you're interested in actually having your hands on a copy of some of the research, just Google Roger Ulrich or Claire Cooper Marcus. They both have great books out as well. So Roger's got a 7-point checklist that we use when we design our gardens, and we test our garden designs with this. And we also evaluate other gardens and whether or not they meet this kind of criteria. You don't have to meet all of the criteria, but you've got to be in the general concept of this, that it provides a place of physical and psychological and emotional well-being, a place for restoration. It provides an opportunity for people to collect and gather and socialize and foster that social support. It has plants, obviously. It has to have real nature to it, and more the better. It can be experienced actively or passively, meaning that someone visiting the campus might just walk into the garden space not knowingly and just want to spend time there. It's intuitive to spend time there because it's a comfortable space that's colorful, has shade, maybe it has sun if it's a cool day out. We have those choices. Or it's an active, they program those spaces. A lot of our senior living communities, they want, a place where they can go out and do a Tai Chi class. Or they want a place where they can go out and do horticulture therapy and work. We like them to introduce these positive distractions. An air conditioner condensing unit with a fan on it is not a positive distraction. That would be what we would call a negative distraction. And they provide those choices. And in some of our gardens, we have challenges in the senior living environments when they're trying to adapt with rehab. Sometimes they want steps. They want the ability to somebody to have a challenge. We did the therapy garden over at Marion Joy's Rehabilitation Hospital, where the entire garden was done and designed in collaboration with the therapist on how they might conduct the same therapies that they do indoors in a garden setting. what a great opportunity for research doctors. Because they can do the identical treatment on a control group of demographic inside, and they can do the same thing outside. We're actually working with the pharmaceutical company to help fund that research. We don't want to do the researchers, because we're biased. We're the designers. We know what the outcomes need to be. But we want to get the evidence so that when the CEO says, prove it, here's some research that says. And obviously, we wanted to improve the place you're living or some sort of medical outcome. So this is Mary Joy. This is the Rehabilitation Hospital. This happens to be one of the labyrinths. It's more of a contemplative spaces. Labyrinths are kind of controversial in my mind, not the function of a labyrinth, but they do occupy a lot of space that is not very flexible. At Mary and Joy, it just so happens, the Wheaton Franciscan sisters, they have their prayer ritual every day, and they come out and they walk this labyrinth every day. It's become an educational tool for the high school kids and other kids who come visit this campus. It's a very contemplative space. One of the elements that we added to this garden was a set of speakers, and it was kind of controversial. They didn't know that they thought maybe nature's sounds should be what is dominating the space, but we added music. The best description I have is it's very kind of zen-like spa music, and it adds an element to the landscape that's very powerful. You walk into that space, you're instantly quiet. And they don't allow their lunches out here. This is purely for meditation and contemplation. A couple of anomalies that happened on this that were just incidental. If you happen to walk the labyrinth and you end up in the very center of this labyrinth, and you'll notice the glass panels in the background, and it's a big circular space. When you stand in the very center, you see a reflection of every. And then if you talk, there's an acoustic anomaly that sounds like you're wearing a microphone, and it's even weird. If you ever get over to the Mary Joy, you gotta check that space out. So here's this idea of supportive design, which is you combine an opportunity to create a space that offers social support, provide patients or seniors who live who want to go into those gardens some sort of sense of control. So when you get institutionalized or you're put into a hospital setting, the first thing that happens is you lose your sense of control. Somebody takes control of where you're going. Somebody takes control of your entire schedule. This garden setting, if you have an opportunity to access it, you pick up that sense of control. You can sit where you want to sit. You can spend as much time as you want out there. Provide an opportunity for movement and exercise, and then also provide this natural distractions. For some reason, guests like to move down. That obviously leads to this stress restoration and buffering, and hopefully leads to some sort of improvement of outcomes. So Roger Ulrich did this study research project, and this was the foundation of his whole biophilic design, which is the idea that the built environment can change an outcome. And he found it was really just a medical research project where he found a hospital that had a patient wing where they did gallbladder surgeries, and the patient wing is where they recovered. It just so happened rooms on the left had a no view out of the window. It was up a brick wall. The rooms on the right, they had a view of a natural environment out the window. Simple as that. And he looked at the medical records, and he looked at what kind of complications they had post-surgery. They looked at their discharge rates, how quickly were they discharged. Their recovery rates, what kind of recovery rates. So he studied a lot of these, and they correlated them to whether it was an even number or not a number on the room. And he found marked evidence that the ones that had the window, the view of nature, got released quicker, had fewer post-surgery complications, used less pain medication than the other group that didn't have a view of the natural environment. And it made him think, maybe there's something to this, so let's do some more research. And so he conducted another research project where they studied cardiovascular patients in recovery. And because they have to recover in an inclined position, he could control what they saw when they recovered. And so over a 5-year period, they measured a control group, and then they measured folks that were exposed to a view of natural environment. The control group was waking up to a white painting that had nothing on it. And then the ones that were waking up and recovering to the natural environment had a view of a natural environment. And then they had, just to throw in another angle, they also had a piece of art that was abstract. It was the half-eaten apple core piece of art. And they measured the outcomes of these cardiovascular patients, measuring their pain medications, their discharge rates, their rate of recovery, and found some pretty interesting data. So this was an idea of the exposure to abstract art, and then this is the natural environment. When in doubt, we always say we prefer the natural environment. But, you know, one of the outcomes of this is that the folks who recovered with the view of the natural environment, to nobody's surprise, had improved medical outcomes, used less pain medications, with discharge quicker than the ones in the control room. But to their surprise, the ones that woke up to the abstract art had more complications, more pain medications than the control room. Pretty interesting stuff. Dr. Joanne Westfall is another researcher. She's the only licensed landscape architect and licensed physician that I'm aware of. And she did a study about limiting access to a garden for Alzheimer's patients. She found a facility where over a 10-year period, they studied patients who were living at this facility. They had a lovely, lush garden, but they limited the access of certain people, and they studied their behaviors, the types of medications that they were on, their recovery rates. With Alzheimer's patients, one of the key indicators of declining health is weight loss. And so they measured weight loss, and they did this over a 10-year period, but they restricted certain patients from how much time they could spend in the garden to none. And they found as little as 10 minutes a day had marked evidence of improved medical outcomes for these patients, these residents that live in that environment. It's pretty cool stuff. So that's another research project that's out there. The other one I want to mention is this. This study was just given an award by the American Horticultural Therapy Association. It was for patients with fibromyalgia. And it was over in, I think, Sweden where they did this study. And they used a control group of patients who were being treated normally and then patients who were being treated the normal way, plus it was in an outdoor environment with horticulture therapy. So they introduced the idea of working with plants as part of their treatment protocols. And they found marked evidence with the ones that were working with horticulture therapy that they had improved medical outcomes than the control group. I challenged the group, and I did it very subtly. I didn't want to do it in the group. Was it the horticulture therapy, or was it the fact that they were outside in a garden that made the difference? So they're going to do another study where they do it in an indoor environment, but they're still working with plants to see if there's improvement. So those research projects are out there as well, and several of these are available online. So what do these spaces really look like, and how do they function? You know, we get asked all the time, mostly by architects who work on hospitals and other senior living environments, we want to create a wander garden. To me, a wander garden, doesn't that sound demeaning? It's like some senior citizen not knowing where they're going and trying to find them. But anyway, there's a lot of common terms for all of these spaces, and they all have different components to it. Cancer gardens in particular have some unique characteristics that you need to think about. Number one is providing dense shade. If you're familiar with chemotherapy, it does make you photosensitive. And so providing a garden that has really dense shade to it would be a really desirable element in a cancer garden. We also get asked all the time, well, what about bees and insects in our gardens? Well, if you're that immune and sensitive, then you shouldn't be in a garden. You should be outside. You should be inside in a bowl. And some are. But if you can get outside into a natural environment, there are elements that you can introduce that, you know, for example, a cancer patient going through chemotherapy might be a little bit more sensitive to smells than us. I might smell a lilac and take a deep breath. They might smell a lilac and get nauseous. And so putting elements within those landscapes that avoid those types of elements might be the kind of thing we would put into a cancer garden. So the applications, obviously hospitals and outpatient centers and senior living communities. But one of the interesting dynamics of the kind of philosophy that we've been using around healing garden design is how do we apply this to just these environments? Couldn't this be a great space at a college campus to have a stress-reducing garden? Have it at a business center. You know, have a meeting space that's outdoors where you're exposed to the natural environment. So we're applying this to these other applications, but I think it's kind of pretty interesting. The other concept that we're using is what I call the micro versus the macro. This happens to be the new Sherman Hospital in Belgium. They have 180 acres on their campus. And in the center of the hospital are a few courtyards where there are some healing gardens. that one of them the patients have access to and the other ones for the visitors and staff. And the theories and philosophies that we're talking about, what elements we like to have in these courtyards, what we like to do is apply that to the bigger picture. So can we reduce stress by making the drive to the front door easier and more intuitive? You know, so from a site planning perspective, taking these same philosophies and applying it to the bigger picture is something that we're doing right now. And so making sure that the front doors are easily viewed, they're accessible, the parking lots are conveniently located. How many people have pulled into the parking lot and gotten to that convenient parking spot and didn't realize that it was convenient? Because I think good design sometimes goes unrecognized. Bad design, people know it. You go into that Best Buy parking lot that was, are there any engineers in the You go into that parking lot that was designed by the engineer, and there's always an island in the middle of where you need to go. It's like, how do I get to the front door? People recognize bad design. Good design, sometimes it's just intuitive. You don't know it, and you still feel good about it. So, interesting theory. So we like to apply that to the macro. This is a Friendship Village up in Schaumburg, one of the garden elements. You notice the benches in the distance. We provide benches so that you can have private conversations, or if you're in a social mood, you can have an opportunity to have that more social experience. I talk about universal design, and a lot of people get confused when I say universal design. Isn't that just meaning it's ADA compliant? No, it's a little bit different. My best description is everybody's got that nasty old metal vegetable peeler in their drawer that's all rusted. Somebody came out with this design for this really nice one that I have, and a lot of people have. Why? It's more comfortable. But it was designed specifically for older adults who have gripping problems. It happens to be the better design, even though it serves multiple purposes. You know, it serves that purpose of assisting an older adult. So that's my best description of universal design. And this is kind of the opposite of that. You know, we have the staircase and the ramp, and it's like, is there a better solution here? So that's how we incorporate universal design into our components. This is out at Edward Hospital. They have a water garden that's a great positive natural distraction. So some of these ideas of social support in our senior living environments, these putting greens are very, very popular right now. We're taking out more shuffleboard and putting in more putting greens for some reason. But senior living communities are kind of like big giant cruise ships, and you have to adapt your spaces to what the people want. And so in some of them, they like the shuffleboard, and in some they like the putting greens. We like the intergenerational opportunities of these active zones. We have these freestanding planters. This is up at St. Patrick's Residence in Naperville. And the residents have the ability, this is an Easter egg hunt. And so they use these circular planters to assist with Easter egg hunt. One of the elements that we like to incorporate in our senior living environments are these shade trellises, but one of the problems that they have is they create these shade patterns that if you have macular degeneration or eye impairment, you might see the shadow pattern as a hole or a step. There's a video I got to get of at the center at St. Patrick's, there's two intersecting corridors. And in the center space, they had an aviary, and it's kind of a social space. But the architect used a very dark laminate flooring. All the other tile floors are white. And you ought to watch the people, the seniors, and even the staff, walk down that hallway, and when they get to the dark center, they walk around. And it's just, it's an interesting phenomenon that occurs, but these patterns of, you know, shadow and light and shadow and light can look like steps, or it can look like make you uncomfortable. So one of the tools that we've been using to accomplish, you know, less of these shade patterns is these perforated metal panels. And the gentleman sitting in his chair, this is one of these perfect days where to get a senior to go outside is really hard. It's either too buggy, it's too humid, it's too wet, it's too cold, too hot. This day was 75 degrees, no humidity. It was absolutely perfect now. It's one of those days where it's cool in the shade and warm in the sun. And that was his comment. His right hand was in the shade, and he says it's cool, and his sun hand, the left hand was in the sun, and he said it was hot. So he thought that was pretty cool that this perforated metal panel actually functioned a bit good enough. Obviously, providing the sense of control. If you go into a garden setting and you just want to think and you don't want to talk to anybody, you want to disassociate yourself from the institutional world, having these ideas or these opportunities where you can have that choice and provide yourself with that sense of control. Obviously, providing movement and exercise. these are the natural distractions. This happens to be the view of a window out of a children's hospital, Christ Hospital. This is the view that the cancer treatment center. And so we provided this natural distraction for that opportunity. And this is out of the wings of Pope Angel Garden, where a lot of the plants that were introduced attract butterflies. It was kind of a sad story. We arranged for the hospital to get a couple hundred butterflies to release during one of their dedication ceremonies, and they got these butterflies. I don't know how they keep them alive, but they come in like a FedEx package. And they released over 150 of these monarch butterflies. It was just a beautiful, they flew away, and all of a sudden, it's like, oh man, they just flew away. But they came back and landed on the plants, and they hung around. So these ladybugs now, because we discovered in our urban environments on roof decks, when we released butterflies, the seagulls had a field day. And so the ladybugs worked really well. And they come in a FedEx box without any hacking. I don't know how they did it. They came out alive. So can you believe you can order online 5,000 ladybugs? It was like $60. So over at Edward Hospital, they had a cancer center. One of the facilities managers just got back from Edward Hospital from Disney World. He saw this cool laminated water, you know, these cool water displays. He wanted to do that as part of the cancer center. He actually wanted it to be interactive, where there was a keyboard in the cancer treatment room that you could play and the water would squirt. And we thought, God, my 15-year-old son would love that. But if he was going through chemotherapy, is that really the right kind of positive distraction? And so instead of debating its merits, is it right or wrong? I don't think there is a right or wrong. But if in doubt, think what nature would do and go to it more of a natural setting. So in lieu of we talked him out of spending the money because it was hundreds of thousands of dollars. We ended up designing a landscape that used natural waterfalls and evergreens and just enhanced the view that the patients were having outside of the windows. This is the cancer hospital in Plainfield. And the patients and the doctors have a putting contest, and this is accessible to the patients. They take their little IV bottles on a set of wheels, and they go out and have a putting contest with their cancer doctor. It's pretty cool. They get out and smell the fresh air, and they can have that natural environment. They intuitively think it's beneficial. I don't think they care if it is or not. They just enjoy doing it. So some of the characteristics, these flexible spaces, seasonal interest, what do they look like year-round? The winter landscapes as well as the summer landscapes, engaging to the senses, the tinted pavement that I talked about, this transition from indoors and outdoors. That lower photograph, I love it because the social area, which is right by the front door, is very, very popular, but you'll notice in the distance underneath in the background is a lady sitting by herself in a wooden chair. It's more of a garden setting. And that's that sense of control, providing that social opportunity and works really well. Movable furniture, if you can afford to have a space that's got the security and you can have the movable furniture, it works very, very well. Things to avoid, sometimes it's the obvious ones, but just for example, obviously we don't like to use and incorporate our poisonous plants. Kind of the busy painting patterns I talked about, you know, with walking, it gives you nausea just looking at it. I think the rectilinear forms in a formal setting, a formal garden setting, I think it works well. But if it's abstract and makes you think, maybe not appropriate for a healthcare environment. This ambiguous art, that was a $250,000 gift, and it was at a psychiatric hospital. And they had to pay to have it removed. All the comments and all the feedback, all the resident surveys were, wow, death, dying, going to hell, you know, all this other stuff. Nothing positive came out of that art. So you got to be careful about, you know, donations. At Edward Hospital, they had somebody who spent a lot of money and wanted to give the hospital a garden, and they had these, the best description I had of them is, remember the monkeys from Wizard of Oz? Mm-hmm. The freaky monkeys? They had those freaky monkeys as a garden ornament, and I was like, well, God, get rid of these. They're like angels, but they had monkey faces. So we found a new one. Another good example. Don't stare at it too long. Don't stare at this one too long. This was actually the Wings of Hope Angel Garden concept. They came from one of the parents. And the foundation president came to me and said, help. This is the idea of memorializing mothers and parents who have lost newborns. And she goes, it looks like a morgue.
Yeah.
And these little pink feet and blue feet was their idea of the design. And so we became the buffer to come up with the new design. And one of the things that our designers instantly saw was the feet look like butterflies. Let's convert the feet to butterflies. And so we created that butterfly garden. And so this was the design. If anybody's been over to Edward Hospital to see the space, it's a terrific space. It's used very, very heavily. Another opportunity that happened, that are just eating challenges. This was the cancer center out of Hope, the Hope Cancer Center at Christ Hospital. And you'll see in the background, the light gray was the old driveway, and the dark black is the new driveway. And they came to us, and they had some money from their foundation, but not a lot. They wanted to create a healing garden, so the patient rooms of the kids had a view of the natural environment. But they were going to restore this temporary driveway back to the permanent condition. And the space that we were left with, number one, the grade was sloping down. It was just too small. And we asked them, is the temporary driveway, does it work for you from a circulation perspective? They said, yeah, we actually kind of like it better. We said, leave it. And what was interesting is the contractor said, well, I got an extra $400,000 to restore the driveway back to its original condition. Why don't you take that and build a garden with it? So all of a sudden, they had, you know, $500,000 to build just a terrific garden for staff and patients and visitors. And so this is the design that was that came up with. We had all of a sudden had all of this space, that, you know, and then it was funded. What a terrific win-win. So these are some of the photographs of that. And then I wanted to mention just real quickly, how much time did I mention? Okay. So St. Patrick's Residence, local skilled nursing facility here in town. And you'll see in the red circle area is a roof deck environment that was designed about 10 or 15 years ago. And I was speaking with one of the ladies. Let's see. This was their idea of horticulture therapy. And it was fairly limited. They had some accessibility issues. And I remember getting my car there and her looking at me and saying, nobody ever comes out here. Why would we ever invest a dollar in this space? Well, I know why they don't come out here, support. And they put this fence in because the windows on the left are patient and resident rooms, okay? And they were worried about privacy. They were worried about somebody like me peering in the room, and it's a resident room. And so that was their solution. They created this kind of a cattle chute, and there was no landscape. And so we came up with the design, and we convinced her. She obviously said yes. But she said, I don't have any money, so you gotta help me raise some money. So we produced this concept sketch, and they held a fundraiser, and they raised $80,000. The reason I like talking about this one, this isn't a $2.5 million healing garden. This isn't a $500,000 healing garden. This is an $80,000 healing garden. It's still a lot of money, but how can you leverage $80,000 to create a transformation that is impactful? And so they raised $80,000 off of the sketch. We were lucky that we had kind of this existing structure that was designed for live load. We had all of the pavers, which we could reuse. We removed that fencing and put it all on the perimeter and raised it up, so it was a very secure, safe space, very inexpensively. And then made it a garden. And one of the things we told them is that we could put plants in between the windows and improve the views out of the resident window to the garden and create that buffer the same way as that fence. Now, that old senior can get up an 8-inch step and walk through a bunch of plants to get up to the window, then they got bigger problems. They would have climbed the fence. So this idea of butterflies once again, and then this was some of the build work that came out of that. This water feature was from Aquascape, and it was just a simple, you know, $1,000, $1,200 water feature that really provides. They didn't want any pools or ponds, so it just goes into a basin that's into the landscape and very easy to maintain. They drain it in the winter. This is the space after. Yeah. Pretty impactful for 80 grand. Trees. We had 18 inches of soil that was mounted to 30 inches, and they were located strategically over the columns. So we have ample soil to grow these trees. Eventually, the trees will reach their maximum and eventually stop growing. They won't die, but eventually they'll die. But you know, they'll become somewhat bonsai. mentioned the gentleman with the cold hand and the warm hand. And this is a view from above. You notice the handrail? Their therapists come out there and they take the walkers away and they have their residents practice using walking without the walker, but they use that railing for stability. And then these are the various elements that we like to talk about. It drives me crazy because the furniture is never where I designed it. And I have to go out there every day and kind of rearrange the furniture. This is down at, now this is a $2.5 million on the opposite. This is a children's hospital where we had a donor, a retired executive from Caterpillar, give us $500,000. His company matched it, and the company matched that, and the foundation put in another $500,000. This is one of the busiest helicopter hospitals in the country. It is a it's in Peoria, but you can imagine all the sick kids get shipped to Peoria, and they come by helicopter. They get 8 to 10 trips a day. Helicopter trips. And so this garden space that we were going to use was impacted by the helicopter traffic. This was the before, kind of a dismal space. All of the views of the patient windows, these are all NICU floors, sick babies, on all four floors overlooking the garden space. The view beyond was the river, spectacular downtown Peoria. Obviously I mentioned the helicopter traffic. So this was the design, and we kept a third of the garden accessible to the public, and the other third is more just garden but not accessible to the public. That's how we dealt with the helicopter traffic. Phenomenal space. We're on a roof environment. We wanted to create 2 foot high or 2 foot wide, 5 foot high stone walls, but the structural engineer laughed at us. So how do we create these incredible retaining walls? And these are actually glass fiber reinforced concrete that are backfilled with styrofoam. Literally, they only weigh a couple hundred pounds and gave us the ability to get a natural stone wall on a roof environment. Other structural engineers come out there and they shake their head. How did you do this? Well, because these stone walls were incredible. These shade structures were to replicate trees, but they also buffered wind from the helicopter in addition to the noise and the wind. So when people are under there, you know, it's a little bit more comforting. They ended up very cool shapes. We got the wood paving, once again, access to nature. There's speakers out there. The space was designed primarily for the parents and families of the sick babies. There wasn't any place on the campus that a parent or family could go to have a private respite moment that wasn't public. And so that's one of the criticisms of this space. The only access is through that secure floor. So there's other people in the hospital that want to get access to this garden. And so their challenges are, how do they accommodate that? But the views from the inside were just dramatically improved.
Is that perforated metal?
It's steel grating. It's similar to perforated metal, but it's steel grating. These curved stone walls, because they were made out of molds, gave us the ability to provide curve and to provide lighting integrated into those metal panels very cost effectively. Terrific space. This is one that just got finished last year. This is at a senior living community. One of these dead spaces that had no access, and they wanted to provide a garden setting. They held a fundraiser. This was about $180,000 worth of improvement. This is the rendering of the design of what it was going to look like. And then this is the building. Unfortunately, there's no people in these senior living communities. It's kind of hard to get photographs. And then this is one that's under construction right now. This is up in Conemaugh, Wisconsin. This is for a behavioral health hospital. And this is a garden dedicated to the very first patient that passed away at that hospital due to suicide. And so this is in his honor. And this is the stuff under construction. And I hope to come back sometime and show you the finished pieces of it. With that, I think I'm done.